There we go, ladies and gentlemen, Starsky and Hutch! Paul, my brother, is here in first David Soul. We're going to do a little bit of the Q&A first with the guys.
This is a very select
group. Yeah, we'll get feedback though if we don't. But I'm going to give the microphone to them. They'll have one.
Hang out in front of the police station, and we turn around and take care of these guys. And then we get through and we walk down the sidewalk. And I said, you know, if you really want to go after the Starsky and Hutch fans, you'd let David and I, as we walked away from you, have an argument about the car, you know. You know, that'd be a smart thing to do. But Hollywood's never been accused of intelligence, so.
Yeah, they tried that with the Dukes of Hazzard. That didn't work either. It's like, let's alienate 80% of the people that are the fans and make it a spoof of a stupid movie. But anyway, let's talk real quickly about the car. I mean, how do you pick a Gran Torino for...
Okay.
Don't talk to us about that.
But I mean, what were your thoughts on that?
I walked out into the parking lot with David. And Aaron Spelling, the producer, was with us, and his arm around my shoulder, and he said, I got a surprise for you. And he pointed at the car. And one of us said, that looks like a spread tomato. Which I made a painting of, by the way, because that's what I do now. I do a lot of painting. And it's for sale. I turned to David, and I said, I'm going to destroy the car.
And I destroyed my car. But this, I mean, talk about undercover cops, right? Here they come. Yeah.
What's funny is getting on YouTube and watching the fans that have put these montages together. Uh-huh. And it's amazing the chemistry that you guys had through the years on that. I don't think there's ever been a TV show that's had two chemistry people that played off each other the way these guys have, right?
Well, you forget the early days. I think the only show that I saw, the film that I saw before of Starsky and Hutch that traded on the same sort of thing was Freebie and the Bean. That was the first like buddy cop thing that I saw. But this was the very first television show that did that.
Who was it, Freebie and the Bean?
I can't remember. I just remember that it was in San Francisco. Set in San Francisco. Anyway,
Streets of San Francisco.
It broke a barrier kind of our show, and then you started to get Cagney and Lacey, and then you got
Magnum PO.
What you call it?
Los Angeles.
Yeah. Yeah, and you got the one you're talking about.
Oh, O'Doobie. The Dukes of Hazzard.
Yeah.
Now, here's the interesting for you folks who don't know, this car right here was actually the movie car, right, from the motion picture. So when the guys come out at the end and you see the chemistry and the deal, he says, and what's the famous line that you used to say, Paul used to say, don't drink coffee in the car, what was it? Something you used to always say, don't drink coffee in the car. That I was Googling your famous lines in the TV show.
Oh, really? I didn't know that was a...
One of them was on the list.
Yeah.
You know?
Don't drink coffee in my car.
That's not all we did.
Well, there's a scene too where I guess David, you're in the back here and you're talking, or maybe you were driving. I don't know. I think Paul was driving, but you guys are bantering back and forth, and you keep looking at him in the rearview mirror. And I forgot what the scene was, but it was hilarious. It was you two were. I think it was you, David, that was in the back of the car, and you're like half out of it, and you're like, you know, something like. God, I don't even know now. I stayed up till 3 in the morning Googling all this stuff the other night. This is, I got to remember that scene and then I go and forget it. So
we had a lot of fun. He and I had a lot of fun.
We really did.
Did they save a lot of the outtakes back then? I mean, and use them? Are they on some of the DVDs?
The outtakes. outtakes.
Because the outtakes, well, there are outtakes I've seen on YouTube. Yes, they're pretty profane.
You would love the outtakes, I'll tell you that.
That was supposed to be the Christmas reel for the crew and all the families. At Christmas time of the first year, we were having a Christmas dinner, and all the families were coming, and they put that together.
Yeah.
And when they saw what they had, they didn't screen it. They wouldn't screen it.
I never heard the S word.
The filthiest stuff you've ever heard in your life.
That is funny.
We did a scene once, and we got, you know, you get into situations where, you know, the pressure's on, and so forth, and you've got to get this thing in before lunch or what have you. So, you know, they're going to go into golden time, and they're going to be having to pay the crew three times more, that kind of thing. And you get to a point where everything is just so ridiculous, all you can do is laugh. And it doesn't take a funny line. All it takes is just a line, and you look at each other, and you can't stop laughing. 56 takes it took us to get through this one. And that, it was, I mean, the tour was just, and you break each other, totally break each other up.
You're working very long hours, and you get silly. And you get silly, and the strangest things set you off. We get to a certain point, like on Friday nights.
Yeah.
On Friday nights, we'd be working together, we'd get ready to go, and I'd turn and look at you, and I'd see something. And then you do the same with me, and we just
kept. And what's funny is you guys get giddy with each other, half the crew doesn't even know why you're laughing.
We took the crew in with us, and they were very much with us. I mean, we were the most ridiculous family you ever saw. I mean, we really was fun. It was just.
We have lost our teeth coming.
Oh, true. Yeah. Anything else?
Anybody?
Come on,
Claude. Come on. I know you got a question.
Just have a chat.
What's your question?
Howdy, y'all.
How you doing?
Over the years, y'all made this show, y'all made such a wonderful series that it's grown across generations. Your show ran, what, 40 years ago? How long was the beat?
Roughly that.
About 40 years ago, and that's, I'm 25. And your show is one of my fond memories that I have from my childhood. We watched it on VHS. And y'all were one of the big reasons that I chose to go into law enforcement. What? How does it feel to have that kind of effect, to have had that kind of profound reach to such a large group of people as actors?
I think that the one thing that we always cared most about was being as honest as we could be on camera, be as much there as possible, because we both believe that, you know, that's what people relate to. If they believe you, if you believe you, then you get a communication going. And so that's the thing. That was the bottom line. That was the bottom line of the whole trip. The fact are the funny lines, the this and that. And I think that was all well and good, but the fact of the matter was that David and I, at that time, with the actors coming into television, neither of us expected it to be a series. We both had our eyes on feature careers, and we both came in with a theatrical background, so that meant that we were very much in tune with being the artist, and not just doing it for the gag, for the fun of it, or for any of the other stuff. So, you know, that I think is what connected people. And whether we've been shoemakers, we were probably given birth to a lot of shoemakers. I really think that that's an important thing to the things you see on television now that you relate to and feel good about is because you can relate to the person. That's all that matters.
And a lot of that, only, I mean, I think I totally agree with what Paul said. The honesty, and the other thing is trust. The trust, but it shows the trust between each other. You're not looking to steal, you're not looking to take away, you're looking to work with not just him, but everyone around you. The better an actor is against you, the better you can be. Do you understand what I mean?
Yeah.
So it works that way in life. It works that way with whatever you do, you know. And that was the experience that we had. There was an honesty there. There was, when we were pissed off, we were pissed off. When we were happy, we were happy. When we always went to work. And always worked with people. And that's real important. I can't think of any moment during the whole 4 years where we said, get somebody different than that. I can't handle this guy.
I think it does.
Except him. And get rid of him. You know. And oh, by the way, while you're doing that, get rid of him. Wouldn't be Starsky Hutch at all. We could bring anybody else in, it wouldn't happen. Maybe some of that goes back to our days in New York. You know, we knew each other from New York. Not great, not well, but back in the 60s, we knew each other. And so there was some sort of relationship that we had. And then I guess it paid off. Anyway, I hope that answers your question. That's the kind of thing that goes on, that's longevity to it. You know, when you have that kind of relationship.
You got a question, Brooklyn?
Just wondering if either of you went back and did any theater after Starsky and Hutch ended.
I did a few. We both did.
Theater? You did theater.
No, did they?
She said, you go to theater.
Theater?
Yeah, theater.
Oh, God, yes. David did a whole mess of theater.
Yeah, Brandon?
I had a very good fortune to play I live in London. Have for the last 23 years, and I've done a number of West End shows in London, which is comparable, I guess, to Broadway. The most successful one was a thing called Jerry Springer the Opera, and it's a hoot.
He was very good at
it. Very funny, very, very funny.
Randy, you got a question?
I, 5 years ago, I came out of the theater, and after the show I did a couple of small things. I did something in Atlanta, someplace else, and then I started doing these Broadway, these British pantos in England, where they play fast and loose with the musical lyrics to well-known musicals, and they cross-dress, and they have local talent, and all of that. And so I did those. Couple of those, and then I was offered Fiddler on the Roof 5 years ago, and I did a tour through Ireland, Scotland, and England. That was probably the best role I ever played, Matt Starsky.
Oh, he was great. He was absolutely fabulous, man. I wish I was a rich man.
Something's got to give.
Hey,
you can't forget about something's got to give.
What?
Something's got to give.
Oh, something's got to give. That was it. Right, that was, something I had to give.
Real quick, you said earlier that, you know, you do some painting and you do a little writing. Before you leave, I want to know what it's going to take to get that painting of the car, okay?
So get the painting?
The painting of the car.
Well, the painting of the car, you go to Department of Good. DepartmentofGood.com, and they have, it's a website that is that really helps local artisans sell their things, and my Striped Tomato is on that website. It's a it's about 24 by 36 inches, maybe it's a little bigger than that. Yeah, so it's pretty effing cool, Benji.
Anyway, it's very good to hear about y'all personal lives, because at the beginning of the day, y'all people, okay? And then, you know, you actors, and we love and love the series. I love it. I love the car. I'm a motorhead. But Dave, what do you do, man? What you've been in theater? You living in London? What do you do for fun?
What do I do with what?
What do you do for fun?
Hit it on the nail on the head there. Nothing.
Just a reminder.
I want to get Randy. Oh, you got one last question here? Let's get one more. Yeah. What do you got?
I wish that Huggy Bear was here, but I wanted to find out, are you still seeing David?
Yeah.
But are you still seeing, what's her name? Are you still seeing
what's her name?
Am I still singing what's her name?
Are you still seeing what's her name?
Yeah. Are you still seeing what's her name?
Seeing what's her name?
What's her name?
I don't know.
What's her name?
Huh? And are you still giving her your thingamajig?
You're still giving her your thingamajig.
What's her name?
What's her name?
Yeah.
What's her name?
The one you were
saying.
What's her name?
Who's on first?
Yeah.
Well, I want to know, David, does the shape machines work at McDonald's over in London?
Yeah.
Yeah, David, did the shape machines work over in London, the McDonald's over there?
Oh my God.
The shape machines, do they work over there at McDonald's? Because they don't work here. The shape machines, the vanilla shape machines. The shape machines, vanilla shakes, milkshakes. Does the milkshake machines work over there? Because over here, when you go through McDonald's, you know, they go, sorry, the shake machine's down. I just want to know over in England if they actually work.
What is he talking about?
It's just, I've got
a vendetta. They work perfectly.
Thank you. I've got a vendetta going
on over here.
Is your thingamajig working over there?
Yeah!
I was going to buy it.
There you go. Hey, I want to get Randy up here. Randy, come here. Randy Klubot, ladies and gentlemen, one of our councilmen. We're going to get the guys a...
There he is, Randy.
There you go. I'll let you say a few words here.
Actually, no one. People counsel me. I'm an elected official. They tell me what they want. And mostly what they need.
That's good.
Want to tell you guys on behalf of Ascension Parish, you know, we have parishes here.
Yes, I know that.
And on behalf of Ascension Parish and the parish council and our parish president, Mr. Matthewson, we're very proud to have you guys in our facility, in our place.
That's
man, I'm going to tell you what, this is 40 years overdue.
Amen.
There's a lot of things that are 40 years overdue.
Yeah, we're fortunate, aren't we?
Yes, indeed. Once again, thank you, Scott, for all you've done, and we got a little...
Oh, that's nice.
Oh, is that cool?
It's very cool. Ooh.
A little bit.
That's no lightweight here.
There you go.
Oh, wow, look at that.
Oh, that's
state of Louisiana.
There you go.
State of Louisiana. You know, my son lives in Shreveport.
There you go, that's good.
And he's got his girls down here. Jeanette and here, they play with their big measure.
Oh, that's right.
Just
the head basketball coach around this
year. Yes, indeed.
Here, hold up your awards. You got to fix it real quick.
Oh, is it heavy? That's a heavy dude. I'm upside down, I think.
Once again, thank you very much. You want to hold on? We'll get someone to hold it for you.
Thank you
very much.
Randy, thank you.
Thank you.
Do you sing?
I used to, but through good lessons, I've learned not to.
I see. But I got you there, didn't I?
I was the president of the local theater.
Oh,
okay. I had children that graduated from Columbia University and New York and also Seattle Film Institute.
Yeah.
But we're good old hometown people. This is the people that these people up to these the people.
Yeah!
That's really hard to come see.
Yeah, baby.
Well, it's great to see you.
Great to see you.
I know it's a pleasure for us to be able to meet fans after all these years.
Yeah. You certainly are far away from us.
So
it'd be much better if we were stuck out there somewhere.
One last story here. I have a something that's special to me. Back in 1976, I was in a Cub Scout. I lived in Columbia, Missouri. And my father got me into a Pinewood Derby contest.
What?
Pinewood Derby, you know, little cars that you fix up. And so he pretty much, I mean, he made me do the car. He worked with me and we fixed the car up and everything, and I sanded it down and everything. And he said, okay, so, you know, tomorrow we're gonna go race this car. And he said, now you need to paint the car. What are you gonna paint it? I said, I'm gonna paint it like Starsky and Hutch. Now this was in 76. So I got upstairs and I was painting the car and I didn't have red. I had white, but I didn't have red. So I had this ugly dark blue. So I painted it blue and I put the white stripe on it. He goes, come on, we gotta go. I said, I just painted the car. He goes, well, we got like 10, 15 minutes. We put it in front of a fan and the fan blew all the paint literally all over the car. So it looked like a piece of crap, okay? It dried and I took this car to the Pinewood Derby. It didn't even roll. I don't know what happened. They got it up there and it didn't even roll down the true story. So I was devastated and I went, you know, sat up there with all the other kids and they were handing out the awards and they called my name. And I was like, my God, what are they calling my name? They gave me an award. Of course, back then when you're a kid, you think, well, you got an award because you're just the shit. Yeah, you know what I mean? But I found out later they gave me the most creative car because it looked like I did my own car and the dads did the other cars for the kids. And they felt sorry because my car sat on the top and didn't even roll. I mean, you couldn't even blow it, it didn't go down. So, true story, we were on our way back home, and we were in the car, and this song right here came on the radio. But can you play us a little piece of that? And as a seven-year-old kid, I'm driving down the road, and I got that award in my, you know, sitting there, and I thought I was the bomb. And this song came on. So you know you have to, you know, you gotta do this. You ready? Don't give up on us, baby.
Yeah.
Don't make the wrong seem right. The future isn't just one night. It's written in the moonlight. Painted on the stars. We can't change us.
Everybody, here we go.
Don't give up on us, baby. We're still worth one more try. I know we put the last one by just for a rainy evening. Maybe stars are few. Don't give up on us, I know we can still come through. Ladies and gentlemen, you ready to get autographs from Starsky and Hutch? Starsky and Hutch. I'm not with Target. Okay? All right, so what we're going to do is we're going to let the guys get to their seats, and what do you all want to do first? You want to do the photo ops in the cars? Okay.